trouble is brewing. It starts when resident Carlos Wilson is jolted awake by someone knocking on his sliding glass door.
Carlos!
Peering outside, he sees his neighbor and beloved uncle, 46-year-old Reginald Day.
Reginald was at the door. I open it and immediately I see him bleeding and gasping for air.
Oh man, oh my God, what happened to you?
To Carlos's horror, it appears his uncle has been stabbed in his side.
I was hysterical, but I tried to keep Reggie calm. Well, I held his wound, made the 911 call.
911, where is your emergency?
I need an ambulance to Century Oaks Drive. And my uncle just got stabbed.
Is he awake?
Yeah, but he needs help back.
Police and paramedics are on the scene within minutes.
Hey, man, what happened?
Oh, man. He got stabbed.
Mr. Day was bleeding heavily from a wound right under his armpit.
Attempting to staunch his blood loss, they immediately transport Reggie to a nearby trauma center.
They proceeded to take him immediately to Duke Medical Center, where he was operated on by the emergency personnel.
With Reggie in surgery and his fate uncertain, officers try and ascertain what had transpired.
Tell us what happened.
Speaking to Carlos Wilson, they learn that Reggie lives in a nearby apartment with his 32-year-old girlfriend, Crystal Mangum, and her three children.
Where's Crystal and the kids now?
I don't know.
Officers race to Reggie and Crystal's apartment. There's no sign of Crystal or her kids, but what they find is deeply disturbing.
We're gonna need to call for backup.
Go ahead and advise major crimes and x-ray.
It's as if a tornado was in the inside of the apartment.
We have knives and weapons all over the floor.
When detectives arrive, it doesn't take them long to see that there's been some sort of struggle.
First thing they see are knives everywhere. Knives on the couch, broken knives, blade here, a handle there.
They called in forensics, the FBI, and the rest of them to take pictures to test the knives and things like that.
They could tell that something very violent and something very aggressive had happened.
Interviewing neighbors, investigators discover there were sounds of an altercation coming from the apartment earlier that evening.
Arguing and fighting.
But that's not all.
And there was another voice, and it was a male.
They heard a third voice, and this was a mystery voice. Nobody knew who this voice belonged to.
But who is this mystery man? And more importantly, where is Reggie's girlfriend, Crystal Mangum?
They didn't know a whole lot at that point, so there were certainly a lot of questions.
But when police start digging for answers, they strike a nerve with everyone in the city of Durham and unearth a scandal involving a prestigious university. A scandal folks in Durham thought they'd buried for good.
See Crystal Mangum?
See Crystal Mangum.
Born and raised in Durham, and the youngest of three children, Crystal Gail Mangum never strove to be the center of attention.
Crystal is really a kind-hearted, good person. Kind of quiet demeanor, not some loud, boisterous, outspoken person.
Bright and pretty, Crystal did well at Durham's Hillside High School until a traumatic event threw her life off course.
It was a gentleman older, much older than she was, that took interest in her and at some point assaulted her. She ended up in a relationship that she shouldn't have been in. It would have been statutory rape. There were charges pressed, but the parents were encouraged to not pursue the case, so those charges were dropped.
Ironically, her own father indicated that he didn't believe that it was true. So we're talking about your parents, the people that you expect to support you, and they're the very first people that are saying, no, I don't believe you, Crystal.
Anxious for a new start, Crystal was determined to put as much space as she could between her and her hometown. So after high school, she joined the Navy.
Crystal was trained as a radar specialist. They sent her to California. She ended up on one of their boats, the USS Monkhood.
But Crystal's naval career was cut short after an embarrassing affair with a married naval officer resulted in two children. Though Crystal received an honorable discharge, she ended her affair with the officer and abruptly returned to Durham with her children. Crystal went back to school and earned a degree in criminal psychology. But even with a diploma in hand, the single mother was struggling to make ends meet.
She still had a very hard time finding employment.
By 2010, Crystal had weathered another failed relationship and had a third child to support.
She was living with her aunt, and, you know, it was a crowded situation.
But in January of 2011, Crystal's run of bad luck took an unexpected turn when she met a successful 46-year-old residential painter named Reginald Day.
They met when he came to the house where she lived at to do a paint job. What's your name?
I'm Crystal.
Hey. Nice to meet you, Reggie.
He was a loving friend, and he was a great person. He had a shirt off his back.
Reggie had a wide network of friends in Durham, but he'd never found the woman of his dreams.
Uncle was very depressed about not having to wake up to someone. He wanted a wife and kids. He was looking for love.
By the time Reginald Day had finished his paint job, he and Crystal had formed a connection.
I just got a big empty apartment by myself.
By yourself?
He was behind on rent, and Crystal had some money saved up, and she let him know that I can help you catch it up if you allow me to, you know, move in.
Reggie jumped at the opportunity. Just 3 weeks later, Crystal and her children moved into Reggie's apartment. It didn't take long for the sparks to start flying.
They just kind of fell into a relationship. She said one night they were just sitting there talking, watching TV, having a few drinks, and, you know, things happen.
So the kids sleep?
Yeah, I put them in bed.
It became romantic and, you know, eventually crossed a threshold.
A devoted boyfriend, three adoring children, a good home. By the spring of 2011, it seemed Crystal Mangum was finally living the life she'd always imagined.
Well, he was a really good man to her, and she cared about him a lot. He was starting to talk about marriage, even though they had been together for just a couple of months.
But just when Crystal and Reggie's whirlwind romance seems destined for the altar, another storm begins to brew. A storm that would rip the roof off their relationship, exposing a closet full of skeletons. For lovers Crystal Mangum and Reggie Day, the spring of 2011 wasn't just a chance to celebrate the end of another long winter. It also marked the six-week anniversary of their whirlwind romance.
Reggie had a ready-made family in about a week of knowing her.
But in the early morning hours of April 3rd, 2011, their lives took a tragic turn when a blood-soaked Reggie shows up at his nephew's apartment, the victim of an apparent knife attack.
It was very traumatic for me to witness that to your own family member.
Reggie is rushed to a nearby hospital where surgeons fight to save his life. Meanwhile, officers have just discovered that Crystal and her three children have gone missing from the couple's nearby apartment.
She was gone. They needed to find Crystal wherever she was at.
Adding to the mystery, neighbors have reported hearing an argument along with the voice of an unknown male that seemed to be coming from inside the apartment earlier in the evening.
At that point, police needed to know if he was involved and who he was and what was he doing there.
While detectives expand their search for Crystal and the unidentified man, investigators scour her and Reggie's apartment in search of any evidence that might offer clues about the attack.
There was knives on the couch. There was knives in the bedroom. There was knives in the hallway. There was blood trails in the hallway.
Near one of the bloodstains, investigators find a clump of human hair, along with a weapon that appears to have been used in the attack on Reggie.
The knife was just an ordinary kitchen knife, maybe about 6 inches long.
After tagging the evidence, detectives continue into the master bedroom.
They saw the mattress off the bed and that it had some blood on it.
The whole frame of the door was off, and there was a big hole in the middle of the door. That had to take force.
It's obvious to investigators that a fight had taken place in the apartment, but it's unclear who inflicted the damage and why. Though investigators have a hunch that the instigator of this attack is male.
Men are generally naturally can be more aggressive than women.
Could this be a domestic dispute gone horribly wrong? Or is there something much darker at hand? With an unknown man still at large, police aren't certain. As for Reggie's friends and family, who've gathered outside the apartment, they find it impossible to believe that someone could have targeted Reggie on purpose, or that he himself was involved in some sort of domestic assault.
I never witnessed any violent behavior from Reggie in any of his relationships.
He was just truly amazing. He would give you his last dime. He was just a good person.
Reggie's friends and family tell police that just hours earlier that evening, Reggie and Crystal had attended a party for one of his relatives.
It was a birthday party for a cousin of mine.
Crystal and Reginald were having an amazing time at a party. They were drinking, having fun, letting loose.
As far as friends could tell, the couple had never seemed happier.
They weren't fighting at the party. They weren't fighting en route to the party.
While no one knows what happened after the couple returned home, friends and family are quick to remind police that the woman at the center of Reggie's love life was no stranger to controversy.
Who's his girlfriend?
Crystal Mangum. The Crystal Mangum.
I explained that was the Crystal Mangum.
In Durham, most people know who Crystal is.
In fact, 5 years earlier, Crystal had been involved in a scandal that rocked Durham and prestigious Duke University to its core.
The Duke lacrosse scandal was something that was heard nationally, not something that was just isolated to North Carolina.
It all started one night in March of 2006, when Crystal and another woman attended a party for Duke's varsity men's lacrosse team, but not as guests.
Crystal was being hired to strip or dance for the Duke lacrosse players.
It was a job the single mother had secretly been doing on and off since 2002.
That's $400 or $500 you put in your pocket. You got children, you got bills. You know, I go dance for a couple of hours, I go home.
But according to a statement Crystal filed with police the following morning, the party went terribly awry.
The lacrosse team had ordered specifically Caucasian strippers. In return, they receive an African-American and an Asian stripper.
Wait a minute. No touching, pretty boy.
No, we paid.
Crystal alleged the lacrosse players were unhappy, and an argument ensued, during which time she and the other woman were called racial slurs. But that wasn't the most shocking charge Crystal brought against the team.
She accused the Duke lacrosse members of sexually raping her.
Specifically, Crystal claimed she'd been violated by three Duke players. Within days, the Durham district attorney brought charges against the young men. Durham exploded.
You have a young black lady saying that three white guys raped her. The whole town was divided.
Half of them believing that something did happen and feeling sorry for, and that other half angry.
The case got national attention, but as the investigation unfolded, private detectives hired by the accused players began to poke holes in Crystal's story. They discovered major discrepancies between what she told police and the evidence CSI uncovered.
The evidence did not back up her story that she was raped.
The attorney general publicly said there wasn't enough evidence to pursue this case and that he was declaring that the young men were innocent.
The whole town was embarrassed by how it turned out.
After her allegations proved false, Crystal became a pariah in Durham.
She thought that everything would be okay. I'd go find a job, good job. That didn't happen.
Once they found out she was the young lady involved with the Duke lacrosse, they would fire her.
Crystal's past certainly raises questions about her potential involvement in the attack on Reggie. But the most pressing issue for investigators is, where is Crystal now?
They were looking for her and her three children.
But before police could pinpoint the whereabouts of Crystal and her children, detectives would get help from an unlikely source, catapulting this disturbing case in a stunning new direction.
And what is your name, please?
Please just hurry up and get here. It really is a lot of trouble. So we just need you to get here really seriously.
April 3rd, 2011, shortly after attending a family party, 46-year-old Reggie Day was brutally stabbed in the abdomen. After investigating Reggie's apartment, Durham police are now looking for his girlfriend, a woman involved in one of the city's most notorious scandals.
This was the Crystal Mangum, the same Crystal Mangum at the center of the Duke lacrosse controversy.
While Reggie fights for his life at Duke Medical Center, police are racing to find Crystal, as well as a mysterious man neighbors claim they heard shortly before the attack.
If someone else was in the house, did someone else commit this crime? Was a child involved?
If there was a third person in the apartment at that time, there's really no way of knowing what happened.
But as police work to determine the other man's identity, a 911 dispatcher receives a disturbing emergency call.
Durham 911, what is your emergency?
This man was trying to beat up on my mom. And my mom was trying to defend herself and she accidentally stabbed her.
Okay, and what is your name, please?
Please just hurry up and get here.
Concerned, dispatchers immediately trace the call. They discover the number is listed to a Durham resident named Liddy Howard. And the address is less than a block away from Reggie's apartment. Racing to the scene, police converge outside Liddy Howard's residence.
Yes.
Ma'am, we're here responding to a 911 call.
When they step into the living room, officers make a stunning discovery.
They come in and Crystal Mangum was laying on the living room floor.
Crystal, I need you to look up at me and talk to me.
They called out to her and she didn't respond, almost like she was asleep.
Crystal, can you stand up?
They had to help her up. She was just out of it.
Having finally found Crystal, officers inquire about the welfare of her children. Fortunately, they're all okay. In fact, Crystal's son is the one who placed the 911 call.
Ms. Howard was caring for Crystal's three children that night. She didn't live very far away.
While first responders attend to a dazed and seemingly traumatized Crystal Mangum, police ask Liddy Howard about the events of the evening. She explains Crystal had dropped off her kids earlier before leaving for Reggie's party.
Was she okay when she dropped the kids off?
She was fine when she dropped the kids off. And she came home around 4 a.m. and she looked like she had been in a fight.
She walked through the door. She said, Red just hit her. Just hit her.
She was distraught. She was in tears. She basically said her boyfriend was beating her and she stabbed him.
She was claiming self-defense, that he had beat her up.
But when police examine Crystal, they see no blatant signs of physical injury. They ask Crystal to describe Reggie's attack on her, but a seemingly groggy Crystal has trouble answering their questions.
The officers had to keep asking her questions. She was falling asleep. She was maybe stumbling over her words or asking, you know, where am I?
Officers transport Crystal to police headquarters for further questioning. But even after arriving at the station, Crystal offers up little information.
I need you to tell me exactly what happened.
Look, I am in pain.
Crystal complains of pain in her face and arm where she says Reggie attacked her. But she refuses to say anything else without an attorney present.
Crystal, who unfortunately had experience with the legal system, did what every defense lawyer in the world would advise, which is not talk.
Right now, I need you to tell me exactly what happened.
I'm not gonna say nothing until I talk to my lawyer.
They took pictures of her, the condition that she was in, the condition that her clothes was in. Was there any blood on her? Was there any marks, apparent marks on her?
Detectives are beginning to think Crystal is hiding something. They hold her in an interrogation room, but they have little concrete evidence connecting her to the crime. That is, until they receive a call from the officers back at the couple's apartment. A surprising new witness has come forward, Durham police officer Christopher King.
He somehow communicated with them to make it clear that he had been there earlier that night.
Officer King tells investigators that he'd been at the couple's apartment complex around 2 a.m., overseeing the towing of an abandoned vehicle. That's when he encountered Crystal and Reggie returning home from their family party.
Hey, don't I know you? How you doing?
She recognized him as a police officer she knew, and she went over to the car.
Crystal said hi to him, which apparently set Reggie off on a jealousy issue, and he started yelling.
Crystal, who is this dude you're talking to?
He was cursing and hurling insults, and he was like, you're cheating on me.
All right,
I know is every time I turn my back, you always talking to another guy.
You are seeing insecure.
Hey. Y'all are going to tone it down, and you're going to take it inside.
The police officer said, you two need to take that in the house. Take that on in the house. And that's what they did.
For detectives, it's a stunning turn of events.
When detectives interviewed the officer, they realized that he was the third voice.
And if Officer King's statement is accurate, perhaps Crystal is telling the truth about being assaulted by Reggie. But how did Reggie end up on the wrong end of a bloody steak knife? Had Crystal stabbed him in self-defense? Or had she or someone else attacked Reggie in cold blood? Unfortunately, Officer King can shed little light on what transpired after he left the scene.
From the time they got in the house, it becomes a he said, she said story because the only people who were there to speak on that was Reggie and Crystal.
With Crystal refusing to speak with police, detectives know the only person who can shed light on what really happened is Reggie Day. Unfortunately, Reggie's condition is about to take a dramatic turn. One that gives investigators pause and makes them wonder, in this bloody encounter, who was the predator and who was the prey?
He said he kicked the door in on the bathroom and dragged her out by the hair.
According to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, in the United States, more than 12 million people a year are victims of rape, physical violence, or stalking at the hands of a partner. That's roughly 24 people per minute. After weathering a very public dispute over the Duke LaCrosse allegations, Crystal Mangum was looking for a fresh start and a man who could love her despite her checkered past. She found that man in Reggie Day.
After that Duke LaCrosse fiasco, Crystal decided that after all of that, you know, she needed to get her life back on track.
I was like, oh, wow, Unc, for real? Do you know who this girl is? He told me, yeah, everybody need a second chance.
But as Reggie's kindness toward Crystal ultimately done him in? In the early morning hours of April 3rd, 2011, Reggie showed up at his nephew's house with a gruesome stab wound.
Reggie was standing before me, you know, holding his wound, his frail body. He told me Crystal stabbed him.
Crystal claims no knowledge of the stabbing and instead tells police that Reggie had assaulted her.
Crystal said conflict became physical. Reggie grabbed her, held her down.
I need to talk to my lawyer.
At that point, she'd exercised her right to an attorney.
Police are desperate to hear Reggie's version of events. But with Reggie fighting for his life at Duke Medical Center, they're worried they might never get the chance. Fortunately for detectives, shortly after Reggie underwent surgery, they received word that his condition has stabilized. He's conscious, but in a lot of pain.
And obviously, there's a knife wound in the side, and they did note a small cut in his colon, which they repaired, and they repaired some damage to a few other organs.
Later that morning, Reggie's finally strong enough to share his story with police.
Reggie, I'm the detective investigating your case. Could you tell us what happened to you while you ended up here in the hospital?
Okay. Well, we were at my cousin's party, and things were just fine.
What's up, cuz? How you doing?
I'm good.
Reggie says that he and Crystal were both drinking that evening. But as the night progressed, he began to wonder if Crystal was having too much fun.
He felt that Crystal was being a little flirtatious and rather disrespectful to him.
By 2 a.m., when they arrived back at their apartment complex, tensions were running high. That's when they ran into Durham police officer Christopher King. It's then that Reggie drops a bombshell. He tells police that in the weeks leading up to the party, he'd heard rumors Crystal had been cheating on him.
He had been hearing from neighbors about Crystal sneaking man in the house during the day when he was at work.
Reggie says seeing Crystal flirting with another man on the heels of his family get-together was more than he could bear.
He felt, well, I've opened up my home to Crystal and her three children, welcomed them in, taking care of them, and this is how she repays me.
You are so crazy and insecure. I'm
crazy?
Yes.
I'm crazy? Every time I turn around, you're talking to some strange dude.
Hey.
You're going to tone it down and you're going to take it inside.
The police officer asked the two of them to take their problems into the home. Shortly after they got into the home, a fight ensued.
Reggie claims that inside their apartment, he told Crystal she needed to move out immediately.
You know what?
What?
You can get out right now. Right now.
He says she ignored him and locked herself in the bathroom.
She got her phone and she tried to call somebody to come pick her up so she could leave the apartment. He wasn't having it.
Reggie acknowledges he was enraged and might have taken things a little too far.
Hey, I need for you to come pick me up. Reggie is going crazy. Just come on, hurry up, please.
All right, you talking to somebody on the phone?
Reggie admits to breaking the door down.
He grabbed her by the hair and was trying to pull her out.
Come on.
To detectives, it sounds like Reggie was the aggressor in the apartment. And if Crystal is indeed the one who stabbed him, she's got a pretty clear-cut case of self-defense. But Reggie claims that once they were outside the bathroom, he let Crystal go. At that point, it was Crystal who then became the aggressor.
He gave them a clear-cut description that Crystal is the one that was trying to kill him. They went into a rage of violence, and the next thing you know, he was defending himself because she became enraged.
She goes into my uncle's kitchen. She picked up that knife.
Don't ever touch me again. Don't put your hands on me. Don't put your hands on me.
He said he was going to leave, but she stabbed him before he could.
He said, she just stabbed me. She just got crazy. She stabbed me.
Given the location of Reggie's wound, his story of the attack makes sense and calls into question the notion of self-defense, as does Crystal's lack of bruising or other injuries indicative of an attack against her.
She had no bruises to say that Reggie was beating her. All Reginald's wounds looked defensive. That he was trying to flee, get away. You know, they was in his back, on his side.
Still, police need more evidence before they can move forward with assault charges against Crystal.
She was being detained, which is a normal procedure in the law enforcement arena, so that the crime scene investigators could go back to the crime scene, get whatever kind of evidence they need.
Specifically, investigators are focusing on the slew of knives found scattered around the apartment. Police can only reach one conclusion. Crystal must have placed them there before fleeing the scene.
There was knives in areas that really did not seem that you should have a knife. It appeared that the crime scene may have been tampered with.
When coupled with Crystal's apparent lack of injuries, the fact that the crime scene had been tampered with gave investigators the ammunition they needed to throw the book at Crystal Mangum.
She was charged with assault with a deadly weapon, intent to kill, inflicting serious injury.
While news of Crystal's arrest is met with relief from Reggie's family, her friends can't believe the turn of events.
I was crushed. I just couldn't believe it. I was mortified.
But before Crystal can get her day in court, this case would take yet another dark and sensational turn. One that would not only leave a community grasping for answers, but would also thrust Crystal Mangum back onto Durham's center stage once again. Less than 48 hours after the near-fatal stabbing of Durham resident Reggie Day, police have arrested his 32-year-old girlfriend, Crystal Mangum. While Reggie admits losing his temper with Crystal, the location of his knife wound, coupled with a doctored crime scene, and Crystal's apparent lack of injuries, has prompted prosecutors to charge Crystal with assault with intent to kill.
He said he was going to leave, but she stabbed him before he could.
After emergency surgery, Reggie appears to be on the mend. So it comes as a shock when just a few short days after Crystal's arrest, Reggie's condition takes a turn for the worse.
He was in a coma, and unfortunately, his family had to make the difficult decision to take him off of life support.
After being taken off life support, Reggie passes away.
I said, what? I said, I just talked to him yesterday.
And I was like, no, man, I gotta see my uncle again. I can't see, I, Not gonna have the last memory of him bending over, gasping for air in my head.
Reggie's passing also means prosecutors will up the charges against Crystal Mangum.
The medical examiner stated that he died due to complications due to a stab wound. And because of that, Crystal Mangum was charged with Regina Day's murder.
The charges carry a maximum sentence of life in prison. But some in the community can't help but wonder if Crystal is being prosecuted less for the attack on Reggie Day and more as punishment for her past transgressions.
That she wears the scarlet letter.
You know, everything she does has been put under a microscope. You can't have a relationship with somebody, and if you do, if they decide to abuse you, you must let them abuse you because you are Crystal Mangum. That's what has been put upon her, and that's not fair to her.
And it's under that cloud of angst and suspicion that Crystal's trial finally begins on November 14th, 2013. Once again, the Durham community finds itself divided.
You had Reginald's family sat in on one side. You had some of Crystal's supporters sitting on the other, and a whole bank of reporters in the back.
In opening arguments, prosecutors assert that on April 3rd, 2011, Crystal and Reggie engaged in a heated argument inside their apartment. And when Reggie tried to defuse the situation by leaving the scene, Crystal lashed out in violence.
They were fussing about her dating other men. She went to the kitchen, got a knife, and stabbed him.
To support their claim, prosecutors highlight Reggie's hospital statement, along with the lack of visible injuries to Crystal Mangum's body.
She had no wounds on her where she like she had been hit. It don't take a rocket scientist to see what happened. She got into an aggressive state, didn't like something that went on, and stabbed Reginald.
While prosecutors only briefly reference the Duke lacrosse scandal, they do zero in on another dark secret of Crystal's, one that could bolster their theory that Crystal had a propensity for violence. Prosecutors call to the stand an ex-boyfriend named Milton Walker, who recounts a bizarre incident that took place less than a year before the attack on Reggie Day.
I saw you in this gate!
She put some of his clothes in the bathtub and set them on fire.
I'm not taking it anymore.
And was screaming that she was gonna kill him. It indicated that she had a terrible temper and that she was willing to become physical during an altercation.
But as defense attorneys are quick to point out, in both that case and this one, Crystal had no choice but to meet force with force.
I think that Crystal felt like at this point, you know, she needed to get on the stand and at least try to tell what happened because she was there. Only her and Reginald know.
Finally, after much anticipation, the woman at the center of this controversy takes the stand. Crystal recounts how their argument escalated in the early morning hours of April 3rd.
She said that when they got back in the house, he was screaming at her.
You were talking to that dude out there.
Hey, I saw you flirting with. That's a friend. I'm not flirting with anybody.
He said Mr. Day punched her repeatedly, knocked her down.
Crystal says she fled to the bathroom, but Reggie kicked in the door and dragged her out by her hair. Retreating to their back bedroom, Crystal says she was stunned by what happened next.
According to Crystal, he went to the kitchen and got knives.
I got something for you.
He started throwing them at her, and she was hiding behind the mattress, which was flipped up.
Oh, so you want to talk to another man?
She said that at that point, when he grabbed her again and he was on her, he was on top of her, trying to choke her.
She reached around on the floor, found one, and reached up and stabbed him.
For those hearing Crystal's story for the first time, it's a convincing tale.
She did a good job on the stand. She's an intelligent woman. I think she presented her case.
But prosecutors fire back and say Crystal's story about Reggie throwing knives is all a figment of her imagination.
There were no knife marks in the mattress that she was supposedly hiding behind.
The prosecution's theory was that she had staged it and she placed the knives where they were just to make like it was more damage and harm done than actually was.
While the forensic evidence contradicts Crystal's version of events, her defense team reminds jurors that it was Reggie, not Crystal, who initiated their fatal encounter.
She tried to get away by going into a locked bathroom. Reggie kicked the door down, went in there, grabbed her by the hair, and drug her out. But at the end of the day, if someone kicks in a door to get at you and is dragging you by the hair, generally you would have a right to respond.
But as this case nears its conclusion, there is one more shocking allegation still to be made. And it might be the saving grace Durham's most controversial resident has been looking for all along.
I definitely think her past run-ins with the law affected her having a fair trial in Durham. I think that it should have been moved to another venue somewhere close where she wasn't really exposed on TV like she was here in the RTP area.
November 14th, 2013. More than 29 months after single mother Crystal Mangum stabbed her boyfriend Reginald Day during an argument, her first-degree murder trial has once again garnered the attention of the national media.
Everything Crystal touches seems to draw a spotlight. There were cameras everywhere.
Crystal's supporters believe the single mother of three is being unfairly prosecuted, in part due to her notoriety following the Duke lacrosse scandal.
Crystal could have jaywalked in Durham, and it would be a major crime. That'll always haunt her.
But prosecutors have asserted the evidence in this case speaks for itself. That Crystal didn't stab Reggie in self-defense, and that her history of lies and violence proves she's quite capable of murder.
It sounds crazy that a premonition of something bad might happen to Reggie when he told me that he was dealing with this woman.
As this case wraps up, defense attorneys make a bold and unexpected move. They claim that Reggie didn't die from Crystal's stab wound.
The ME testified this was an uncomplicated knife wound that fully should have been survivable. He should have absolutely been fine. And the fact that he wasn't certainly is a problem.
The defense introduces Reggie's medical records, which revealed that due to complications resulting from alcohol withdrawal, doctors had to intubate Reggie in order to help him breathe, which the defense claims turned out to be a huge mistake.
That resulted into him having a heart attack.
Blood flow was cut off to his brain. He went into a coma, essentially brain dead.
The argument incenses Reggie's family and friends, who believe either way, Crystal is still responsible for his death.
The bottom line is, Reggie wouldn't have been in there if you wouldn't have stabbed him. You know what I'm saying? And you're to blame. You're the cause for him dying. And that's the bottom line.
But when the jury retires for deliberation on November 21st, 2013, Crystal's defense team is hoping for an acquittal. But they worry that the jury is biased against her.
When they're out, you're hoping that they're listening to all the evidence, that they're not considering that this is the Crystal Mangum.
After 6 hours of deliberations, the jury returns with their verdict. They start with the first-degree murder charge.
They said not guilty. I said, okay, we just about got this.
But then the clerk reads the verdict on the second-degree murder charge.
They said she was guilty of second-degree murder. She put her head back and started crying.
That same afternoon, the judge hands down his sentence.
He sentenced her to 14 years and 2 months to 18 years in prison. And it doesn't seem like a lot unless you're the person who has to serve.
When that judge handed down this sentence, I couldn't even sit in the courtroom any longer. It was all over for me.
For Reggie's loved ones, the verdict brings a sense of both sadness and relief.
It was like a double-headed sword. I'm winning and I'm losing at the same time. It hurts. It hurts.
I wish that she would have gotten more time than what she got and took somebody that really meant something to a lot of people. I just miss him a lot.
But while the pain, controversy, and questions still linger, there's no denying that the unconditional love Reggie Day so desperately craved led him into the arms of the wrong woman. A woman who seemed to leave a wake of violence and suspicion following behind her everywhere she went.
Reginald needed to be needed, and Crystal utilized that. He may not have realized how much she craved things and that he may not have had enough to give her to satisfy those hunger cravings inside of her.